One, part one. So today we will be beginning with band gap references module, that is 1.3. So let us revisit what we have done so far. Yeah, so let us revisit our current mirror. So in the current mirrors, we have studied basic current mirror and cascode current mirror. We have not yet started active current mirror because active current mirror will require some knowledge of differential amplifier. And we have not yet covered differential amplifier topic. So once we cover differential amplifier topic, then we can cover the active current mirror. So that we will complete it after your in semester exam. Now let us revisit what was the current mirror doing. So current mirror was all about copying a current from a reference source or from a current source which has a constant current. So today, we have already discussed in the last week about techniques to copy a current. That is called as current mirroring, right? But we haven't discussed how to generate a reference current, I reference, right? So that is what this is, module number 1.3. So let us revisit our basic current mirror. So we know this is my structure of a basic current mirror, where M1 is a diode connected MOSFET and your VGS1 is equal to VGS2. That's why there is a relation between I reference and I copy, right? So the relation is as follows. I copy is equal to W by L of 2 divided by W by L of 1 into I reference, which is valid for long channel devices. And accurate mirroring, we keep the length of the devices normally the same. So therefore, the revised formula of I copy will be approximately equal to W2 upon W1 into I reference. So this is the way we can scale, mirror, or replicate the current. Okay, that concept we have already covered. So let us proceed now ahead. Yeah. So what is the objective of this reference sources? The objective is to establish a reference current, I reference, and to establish a reference DC voltage, VDD or V bias. So in order to do that, both this reference current and DC voltage should be independent of supply and processor reasons. Okay, and they should have a well-defined behavior with the temperature. In spite of keeping it independent of process and supply variations, still these quantities can vary with temperature. So we have to take care of it. Now, there are certain three forms. Let me just expand it further. Yeah, there are three forms of temperature dependence. So first is it's proportional to absolute temperature. So we call it as a PTAT. Then we have a constant GM behavior and then temperature independent behavior. So based on, the supply variations and the temperature dependent variations, we will design the following two reference circuits, supply independent biasing and temperature independent biasing. OK, so in addition to supply, that is VDD and V bias, process that is GM, mu n, COX and VTH, and the temperature variability that affect the constant current and voltage, some other parameters are noise. So noise also will disturb our parameters such as your supply as well as your other parameters. So these are the other parameters in addition to supply, process and temperature variations. Okay. And we will be designing the reference circuits based on these two main concepts, that is supply independent biasing and temperature independent biasing. So let us build a concept now. I hope I'm audible. So in a current mirror biasing using ideal current source. So what we have is we have seen this type of current biasing, but here what we did is we added one more transistor. We have two current mirrors over here, M1 and M2 and M1 and M3. Right, so ID2 can be written by W by L of 2 divided by W by L of 1 into I. 3 can be written by W by L of 3 divided by W by L of 1 into I reference. Right, and that means my ID2 and ID3 are copies of reference current I reference. Okay, so the use of current mirrors will implicitly assume that a reference current is available. So, we are not worrying about how this I reference is getting generated. But we are making sure, we are assuming implicitly that this I reference is available and that current won't change, either with the voltage or with the process variations. Right, that's an assumption. So basically, if I reference does not vary with validity, and if channel and modulation of M2 and M3 are neglected, then we can say ID2 and ID3 remain independent of the supply voltage. Now how? If you look into this formula, ID2 and ID3, there is no VDD term involved over here, right? So even if there is a fluctuation in the supply, that is VDD, still these two currents won't change at all. Okay, so that's what it means. So question is, now next question is how to generate this I reference current. Fine, so that is what we will be doing from now on. Just to check, the audio and all is clear. So in current mirror biasing using a resistor, we want to generate reference. So what do we do is have a simple mirror biasing using a resistor. Okay, R1. We use a resistor R1, and the current passing through the resistor R1 is my I reference. So as an approximation to an ideal current source, we tie a resistor from VDD to the gate terminal of M1. So let's assume that M1 is in saturation because it's a diode connected MOSFET. And assuming that M1 is a long channel MOSFET, that was on GM1. We have done this analysis, right? So if we want in circuit, can we note it down? So I reference will be equal to VDD divided by R1 plus 1 upon GM1. Simple Ohm's law, right? And since M1 and M2 form a current mirror, we can write I copy current is equal to W by L by 2 divided by W by L of 1 into I reference. And what is I reference from here? VDD divided by R1 plus 1 upon GM1. So I copy can be written as equal to W by L of 2 divided by W by L of 1 into VDD divided by R1 plus 1 upon GM1. Now we know from here that in the I copy expression we directly have VDD supply. So in case if the supply voltage vary, my I copy current will also vary, which is very bad. So that means my I reference is sensitive to VDD. Also my output current I copy is also sensitive to the supply voltage fluctuation. So you should be very careful. So let's say if the supply voltage changes by a fraction. Earlier it was 5 volt, now it has become 5.05. So due to that supply voltage variation, my I copy also have changed by a certain amount. Let's say it was 10 micro, now it has become 11 micro, right? So delta I copy can be written as delta VDD divided by R1 plus 1 upon GM1 into W by L of 2 divided by W by L of 1. That only means that your output current I copy is sensitive to the supply voltage variations. Now, how can VDD vary? You will say ki VDD is a regulated power supply. How it can vary? Now, you all must be knowing that, you know, it's been generated from AC source, right? So we have a AC source, 230 volts, 50 hertz supply. So now we have a transformer over here, step down transformer over here. So after the step down transformer, we give it to the rectifier and then we feed it to the filter. After the filter, we give it to the regulator. And, while filtering, still there might be some ripple, even after regulation. So that means your DC voltage may contain ripples. And that is what the source of VDD variation means. Now, we all know that the AC source also might vary. We know it is around 230 volts normally, but it can vary between 220 to 240 volts. So AC source can vary. So these variations can be transferred to the DC output voltage also. Normally, the output DC voltage is, let's say, step down to around 5 volts. So because of this fluctuations, the 5 volts can vary to 5.05 or 4.95, right? So that is where the supply voltage variations are coming from. Also, in the formula, we have GM1. And in the GM1 formula, we have mu and Cox W by L, VGS minus VTH,
Okay, here my mu n is mobility and VTH is threshold voltage. Now both the mobility and my threshold voltage are temperature dependent. So if I have a increase in temperature by 5 degree or by 10 degree or decrease in temperature by 5 degree or 10 degree, my mobility will change, my threshold voltage will change. So if that changes, my GM1 will change. Now if my GM1 will change, my output current will change. So we will not have a accurate current mirroring, right? So therefore, the current mirror biasing using a resistor, supply and temperature dependent. Okay. So it is both dependent upon supply as well as temperature. So there is an issue with the reference current generation, but the current mirroring is happening properly. Fine. So there, you understand this very carefully, that there is no problem in current mirroring. Only problem is generation of I reference. So how can we address this issue? So for a supply independent biasing, what if I reference is somehow derived from I copy? So idea here is that if I reference is to be ultimately independent of VDD, then I reference can be a replica of I out. Okay, so I mean, here in this case, I out is nothing but your I copy only. Okay, so please note that. Fine, so this is the idea. Any doubt in this, anyone? How VDD can vary and why, how this idea of generating I copy from I reference is a good one? Okay, so let's move on to our actual topic, that is your concept of supply independent biasing. Yeah, so let's begin with that. Okay, let me adjust the width properly. So in this concept of supply independent biasing, our goal is that your I reference must be generated from I copy. So for here we use four transistors and two current mirrors. So let's assume that M1 to 4 are long channel devices. That means we lambda for all the transistors over here, M1 to M4 will be zero. Okay, that's an assumption. So here what do? Is we have two current mirrors. So we know how the current mirror operates. So let's check it out for current mirror number one. So for current mirror number one, M1 and M2 are forming a current mirror, right? And we are assuming the the aspect ratio or the transistor sizing as follows. Transistor sizing for M1 is W by L of 1, and transistor sizing for M2 is W by L of 2, which is K times W by L of 1. Okay, it is K is integer. Let's say 2 or 3. It can be a number. So let us assume that W by L of 2 is K times W by L of 1. Now already we know how to write the equation over here, right? So what will be ID2 given by? ID2 will be given by W by L of 2 divided by W by L of 1 into I reference, right? And so that is what we have. What is W by L of 2? K times W by L of 1. So your W by L of 1 gets cancelled out and we get ID2 as K times I reference. Everyone clear about this? Okay. Let's move on to the second current mirror. So this was current mirror one was NMOS. It uses NMOS transistors, whereas current mirror two is using my PMOS transistors. Okay, so here M3 is my PMOS diode connected load. PMOS diode connected MOSFET, sorry, not load. So here in this case, M3 and M4 form a current mirror. So we can write, and also the sizing is as follows. So the transistor sizing for M4 is W by L of 4, and the transistor sizing for M3 is K times W by L of 4. Okay, so M3 and M4 form a current mirror. So we can write ID4 is equal to W by L of 4 divided by W by L of 3, right? And what is W by L of 3? K times W by L of 4. So we can say ID4 is equal to 1 upon K times ID3, right? So ID3 can be written as K times ID4. So now what we do is we combine this current mirror 1 and current mirror 2 as follows. I hope it is visible. Let me just slightly reduce the font size. Yeah, so what we do is we combine this current mirror 2 and current mirror 1, and we apply the VDD to the current mirror 2, and we take the ground from the current mirror one, and we generate I out, that is I copy from I reference. Okay, so let us check it out now. So this is what the current mirror 2 and current mirror 1 combining looks like. So here we have a I copy current. Now we know that M3 transistor will be in series with M2. So I copy will be same as ID3, which will be same as ID2. So here we can write mod of ID3 also. That is fine because PMOS current is different. I mean, it's in the opposite direction, right? So here, similarly, ID4, since M4 and M1 are in series, ID4 will be equal to ID. Reference. Okay, and we know the relation between ID3 and ID4. So ID4 is 1 upon K times ID3. So hence we can say here over here, I reference is equal to 1 upon A times I copy. So that means we are generating I reference from I copy. Correct? Are you all following what is going on over here? So this is the concept of supply independent biasing. So let's look into the concrete circuit now. So this is my circuit to establish my supply independent biasing. Let me just expand it a little. Yeah, so if you want to note down the circuit, you can note it down or take a print screen of it. We will analyze this supply independent biasing in the next few minutes. So what is the requirement? We have already seen M3 and M4 form a current mirror 2, M1 and M2 form a current mirror 1, right? And the sizing of the transistors are for M1 it is W by L of 1, M2 it is W by L of 2, which is K times W by L of 1. For M3 it will be K times W by L of 4. Okay, and we have I reference and I copy over here. So here the assumption is that all the four devices are in saturation and they are long channel devices. That means lambda 1 to 4 is 0. What do you mean by 1 to 4 for all the four transistors? Now since M1 and M2 form a current mirror 1, and also your ID2 is same as your I copy, and your ID1 is same as your I reference, just to keep in mind. So ID2 can be written as W by L of 2 divided by W by L of 1 into I reference, right? So what is W by L of 2? K times W by L of 1. So over here we get ID2 is K times I reference. We have already discussed this before, right? But now we are discussing it again as a part of the circuit. So this is my supply independent biasing circuit. Okay, now let's move on now. So we know also know that current mirror 2 is formed between M3 and M4. So the current can be written as ID4 is equal to W by L of 4 divided by W by L of 3 into ID3. So ID4 it will be equal to W by L of 3 is K times W by L of 4. So over here we get ID4 is equal to ID3 divided by K. That means ID3 can be written as K times ID4. Okay, and here in this network, if you see carefully, ID3 and I copy are same, which is same as your ID1, ID2, and ID4, I reference and ID1 are all same because M4 and M1 are in series, M3 and M2 are in series. So, you know, ID3 is I copy and ID4, this is ID4, sorry, ID4 is I reference, fine. So that means my M3 and M4 transistors will copy the current I copy, thus defining I reference. So, you know, from here, we can say that ID I reference, that is ID4 is equal to 1 upon K times ID3, right? So we can write I reference is equal to 1 upon K times I copy, right? So that means my your I reference is bootstrapped to I copy, okay? So what do you mean by bootstrapping? Bootstrap means that it refers to a self-starting process that is supposed to continue and grow without external input. Now, if you see over here, there is no external input applied anywhere. So once we generate I reference, that is fed to I copy. You know, we generate I copy, that is fed to I reference, and then again it is fed to I copy. That is what is going on. Okay, so that's what we. That's why we say I reference is bootstrapped to I copy. Now, I reference is 1 upon K times I copy. So I copy will be K times I reference, where K is the multiplying factor. We can have that factor as 2, 3, 4, 5, 10. Okay. And also we are assuming that W by L of 2 is K times W by L of 1. And W by L of 3 is K times W by L of 4. Then definitely we have one equation, that is, this is I copy only. We have written I out. Sometimes it is called as I out. So I copy can be equal to k times I reference. Okay, that means my I copy and I reference are relatively independent of VDD, as you can see over here. But still, it is a function of process and temperature variation. Still, this I copy can be disturbed by process or temperature variations. It is only supply independent, but not process and temperature independent. Now, since the circuit is governed by one equation, I copy is k times I reference, it can support any current level. So let's say we initially force I reference to be 15 microamperes, then the resulting I copy will be k times 15 microamperes will circulate around the loop. So I reference is I copy divided by k. So k into 15 micro divided by k, that will be 15 microamperes. Okay, so this current which will be circulating will sustain the current levels in the left and right branches indefinitely. That means once we have fixed the value of I reference, that I reference will be fed to I copy and that will be maintaining it throughout. Okay, let's say k is 1. So I reference is, let's say, 15 microamperes. So I copy also will be 15, and that 15 microamperes will be, you know, again and again repeating indefinitely in this circuit. Are you understanding? And that is supply independent. That current will be supply independent. Even if there are changes in the supply voltage, still it will keep on, you know, providing the current. Sorry. So this was about the supply independent biasing. But can anyone tell me what could be the problem over here? What is the possible flaw of this circuit? Okay. Anyone? What is the problem with this? Okay. I'll explain you the problem now. So with the improved version of supply independent biasing, the problem in the earlier circuit was we have no control on the amount of current flow. That means there is no design parameter to control I reference or I copy. So once initial value of I reference is decided, that same current will flow. We cannot change that. So there is no control over the supply independent biasing. We cannot change the I reference or I copy current. So that has to change. So we go for improved version 1. Supply independent biasing improved version 1. So because that was a drawback, that there is no design parameter to control I reference or I copy, that's why this becomes a drawback. So the solution over here is to establish control over the circuit, or to uniquely define the current, we add the resistor RA over here in the source terminal of your M2 transistor. So that's the only change from the previous circuit. Okay, this is very, you know, simple concept. Don't get worried about the circuit over here. Once you understand current mirror, knowing that will be very, very easy, right? So we have added RA to establish control and have to have some design parameter to control I reference or I copy current. So here we have four transistors as it is, right? M1 to M4. And in addition, we have RA resistor. So here, in this case, we assume that all the assumptions remain the same as earlier. M1 to M4 are in saturation and they are long channel devices. That means lambda 1 to 4 are zero, right? And from the circuit, we can say that this I copy current will also flow through RA resistor. Okay, so now we cannot say that VGS1 is exactly equal to VGS2. So how they are related? We apply the KVL in the gate source loop of M1 and M2. So we get VGS1 is equal to VGS2. I mean, if you apply the KVL straightforward, you will get VGS1 minus VGS2 minus IARA is equal to 0. So since we are writing in this form, we get VGS1 is equal to VGS2 plus I copy into RA. Okay. Understood this? How do we got this? VGS1 is equal to VGS2 plus I copy into RA. Now ID, we know how we can write ID. ID can be written as half mu n Cox W by L VGS minus VTH the whole square. So VGS can be written in terms of ID now. It is square root of twice ID mu n Cox W by L plus VTH. So we know that M1 and M2 will form a current mirror. And also we assume that VTH1 will be equal to VTH2, which will be equal to VTH. We know the body effect for M1 is 0. That means the VSB1 is 0, but your VSB2 is not 0. Right now, we, for the sake of understanding, we are assuming VSB2 to be very, very small, negligible.
Okay, so that's the assumption. Remember, that is the assumption. So we are assuming that both M1 and M2 are in the vicinity. So they have the same threshold voltage. VTH1 is equal to VTH2. And also M1 and M2 are not suffering from body effect that much. So how can we write this equation number 25.2.4? We will write VGS in terms of ID. So we can write VTH plus square root of twice I copy. Now, why twice I copy? Your ID current, right? So ID current over here is I copy over here. So it will be VTH plus square root of twice I copy divided by mu n C aux W by L of 1 is equal to what is VGS to VTH plus square root of twice I copy divided by mu n C aux W by L of 1 K times W by L of 1. Why K times? Because W by L of 2 is K times W by L of 1 plus I copy into RA. So here we have it. And now what we do is we take square root of twice I copy divided by mu n C aux W by L of 1 common. So inside the bracket, we'll get 1 divided by, 1 minus 1 divided by square root of K, which will be equal to I copy into RA. So now we are writing the equation of I copy. So we take square on both the sides. So what do we get? Twice I copy divided by mu n C aux W by L of 1 is equal to I copy square into RA square divided by 1 minus square root of K the whole square. Okay, so here now we can determine I copy expression. So I copy expression will be approximately equal to 1 upon RA square into twice divided by mu n C aux W by L of 1 into 1 minus 1 upon square root of K the whole square. Okay, so therefore now you can see. Now you can say from expression number 25.2.5 that I copy current is independent of supply voltage VDD. There is no VDD term. And then also one more parameter is there, that is we can, it's a design control. That means we can control the amount of I copy by deciding the value of RA, correct? So that is the power we have over now we can design your supply independent biasing to any level of current, provided we give that value of RA, right? But that's the advantage. The circuit is independent of your supply voltage. I copy current is independent of voltage variations. I mean, there is no VDD term. And also we can have a control over the circuit by deciding the value of I copy. But the problem is that I copy is still dependent upon process temperature and RA value. That means if my process changes, if my temperature changes or RA value might change, my I copy can change. Also, while deriving this I copy expression, we have assumed that the body effect of M2 is ignored. But really, that's a problem. It's not actually, we cannot ignore it, right? Right now, we have neglected the body effect of M2 transistor. So it means that your VTH1 is not equal to VTH2. Why? Because if we have body effect, your threshold voltage will definitely change. Therefore, our underlying assumption that VTH1 is equal to VTH2 is actually a kind of an issue, right? So this is actually overcoming the previous drawback, but it is bringing few more drawbacks which are coming up along with it. So let's see how to eliminate those drawbacks. So already we have seen version number 1 of improved supply independent biasing. Now, what was the drawback in this? Your VTH1 was not equal to VTH2. So how can we eliminate? We can eliminate that problem with a smart improved biasing. So let me show it to you. So this is version 2, improved supply independent biasing and a smart biasing. So what did we do? What was happening? Because of RA being connected over here at the source terminal, your M2 was suffering from body effect. So that body effect was a problem, right? So how can we eliminate that? We will smartly eliminate by doing the biasing like this. So now M2 and M1 are not suffering from body effect. So the earlier drawback is gone. Okay, and rest all the things are same. And here we assume one more thing, that W by L of 3 is same as W by L of 4 and W by L of 2 is K times W by L of 1. Okay, rest all the assumptions are same. So here in this case, the body effect associated with M2 transistor is gone, completely resolved.
So let's write a KVL at the gate source loop of M1 and M2. What do we get? So let me redraw this section over here. So this is the only trick we do over here. RA we include it, but we include it smartly over here. Okay, such that M1 and M2 remain, body effect free. So if I redraw the circuit, same circuit like this, I'll get this network. So now if we apply your KVL in the gate source loop, what do we get? We get VGS1 is equal to VGS2 plus I copy into RA. Same equation we are getting, but this time we can with assurity we can say VTH1 is equal to VTH2, which is equal to VTH. Okay, and now the same thing, I mean the same process can carry out. All the equations will remain the same, even the I copy expression is same, right? So what has changed? Only thing which has changed is that earlier M2, which was suffering from body effect, now it will not. Okay, so we don't have to make that assumption. So here your I copy current is independent of your supply voltage VDD. There is no VDD term over here. Plus there is a design control. We can decide how much can be the value of I copy and hence I reference. And there is no body effect for all the transistors over here. M1 to M4, there is no body effect. That's an advantage. But only disadvantage can be this circuit over here is suitable only for supply independent biasing. It does not take care of process variations and temperature variations. Okay, so this completes the topic of